Well, we're here for game two, and we get a nice hand that would well, would be nice with a land, but unfortunately just some Mox Opals and nothing else is not gonna work. So we have to mulligan. Again, a zero land hand that we have to mulligan. Definitely gonna switch back to 17 lands after this, and again, I guess. I mean, with this hand, if we draw another Ornithopter, then this Mox Opal becomes active, and I play Springleaf Drum, and then like cast Ensol and Volscourge, which together is like a Baneslayer Angel. The problem is, if we don't draw Ornithopter, Memnite, or land, then, well, our hand is not doing anything. I think it's too risky to keep this. Chances of like not drawing some of the cards we need in the first one or two draw steps are just too high, I feel. This, well, is better. At least we have like two mana sources and three non-mana cards. So that's a good mix. We have a mix between early plays and big cards, so that's good. I mean, Arcbound Ravager definitely becomes worse when you mulligan to five, since you just have fewer cards to work with, so less artifacts. But this is still okay. So let's figure out what our opponent is up to. Elvish Mystic. Makes sense. Eh? Green deck with Elvish Mystic. And, of course, Ornithopter. Yes. Okay. I still don't know what this is doing in his deck. But I mean, like a mono green aggro deck with Elvish Mystic and Aspect of Hydra, that I can somehow understand. Seems feels a bit underpowered for modern, but whatever. Well, we're definitely gonna, like, if we play Volscourge, then we would stab it for mana anyway on the next turn with the drum. So might as well play the drum. Because, well, if our opponent has a dismember or something, he won't be able to kill our creature before we get to tap it for mana. So now the second forest, sure. So it probably is mono green. Which would make sense with the aspect of Hydra that I saw in the previous game. Still a big question of what this Ornithopter is doing in his deck. Basara Tower Archer. Okay, so maybe some kind of hexproof type deck, I guess. I don't know. One way or another, I'm just gonna put out this Steel Overseer and yeah, Arcbound Ravager as well. Or maybe actually the Volscourge. No, he would be able to block the Volscourge with the Tower Archer, so I don't want to attack with it on the next turn. And this is also more mana efficient. Also means that he won't be able to attack with the Elvish Mystic, most likely. And if he does, I'm probably not gonna block because I'm a bit afraid of Aspect of Hydra. But the Arcbound Ravager might be a better defender. That's what I'm trying to say. Mean, I might also just be playing against an opponent who is new to Magic and has just randomly assembled a mono green modern deck from the packs that he opened or something. And then I guess he got a buy. Or he just had a great draw and beat someone. Or maybe now he will reveal the big tech. It's really difficult to play against these kind of decks. I have no clue what to expect. Hunter Week. Yes, definitely was not expecting this. That's for sure. If you would have given me a list of modern cards that my opponent would play here, and asked me what will he have, well, Hunter Week would not be on top of the list. Yeah, by now I'm pretty sure that my opponent is just new to the game and randomly assembled a deck, and then maybe he should have tried to go for a standard deck instead of modern. But sure. So he's gonna have a 3-2 and then fight. I could save my Ravager, but then that means sacrificing Steel Overseer. I don't think that's worth it. But I'm pretty sure it's worth sacrificing the drum so that the Tower Arch actually dies after the fight. So that's fine. Yeah, and then it can just resolve. That's okay. To be careful to actually target my Steel Overseer, not misclick on his Ornithopter. It's kind of the sweet tech, play Ornithopter, so your opponent with his Ravager misclicks. But yeah, I should be able to win this one. If I lose this match, right now knowing that my opponent is almost certainly just new and doesn't really know how modern deck construction works. If I lose this one, then that would be quite embarrassing. So, Vault Scourge. And yeah, I'm just gonna keep the mana up. I mean, I could also just pay mana instead of life for Vault Scourge. But then I don't get to put counters on both of my nexuses, which I think is gonna be worth it. Besides, I'm only at 17. It's still fine. When my opponent doesn't really have much of, well, a board. But yeah, what will he play next? Now that he has 5 mana. Maybe a Durwood Boars or something? No Venom Sliver. Well, that's acceptable. Of course you have Venom Sliver in your Ornithopter Hunter Week deck. Again, if you had given me a list of modern cards, this is not what I would have expected him to play. Yeah, I'll probably tell him after the game that well, if you want to play in modern, you probably need to assemble a somewhat more powerful deck. And even if you want to play in standard, then, well, your deck has to have kind of a plan. There needs to be, well, synergy, or at least a role for all the cards. Like Elvish Mystic ramping into Tower Arch and Hunter Week. Yeah, that doesn't really work. If you have something like Elvish Mystic, you want bigger impact cards. Ornithopter doesn't really do anything by itself. I mean, it's great in my deck, but if you don't have cards that synergize with it, it doesn't really do anything. And yeah, Venom Sliver could be okay in some meta games. But once again, not really the most powerful card around. So in the meantime, I'm just attacking for a bunch with my artifacts. The crazy thing is that if my opponent has Creeping Corrosion or something on the next turn, I might actually still lose this one. Though that is fairly unlikely with 2/3/3 Blinkmont Nexuses. Me still at 20 life. Him having, well, 2 combined power on the board, Karametra's Acolyte. Yeah, okay. Again, not the most threatening of cards. Maybe he's trying to ramp into something super powerful. But what could it be? Activate the Nexus, activate the other one. I don't have lethal yet because he can block with Ornithopter. But unless he manages to power out something super powerful with Karametra's Acolyte, and I wouldn't even be surprised if he plays some kind of 8 mana bomb on the next turn that completely wrecks me. Like if he has a Platinum Angel or something, I don't think I can even win. I don't think I put in any way to deal with it. But yeah, I guess my opponent was not exactly ready for the modern format, or ready for like a proper deck construction with kind of a plan. Like Ornithopter, great card in Affinity, not so much in mono green, yeah, random assortment of cards. So we won this one 2-2 in total, not the most impressive record. If I look back at the deck, then I'm not super happy with how it worked out. Well, here we have the list again. What I found in these matches that I played is, on the one hand, that like drawing multiple Thoughtcast is still kind of clunky. Same goes for drawing multiple Ensoul artifacts. When you have two, it often leads to kind of too slow of a draw. It's a lot of mana, especially when you want to put these on something like a Darksteel Citadel or Drum or Mox Opal. And also drawing multiples of these when you have, well, no colored mana source in sight, which also happened, is, well, also definitely, it's just a way to lose the game with an Affinity deck like this. So while I definitely saw the power of Ensoul Artifact and Thoughtcast in the deck, I view these more as cards that you want to play like two copies of, for example. Same like Master of Ethereum and Edge Champion and Galvanic Blast. You can choose the mix, but in most games you are happier when you draw like one Ensoul Artifact, one Thoughtcast, or like one Master of Ethereum, one Galvanic Blast, for example, than if you draw two copies of one of those cards. So that's why I prefer a mix. They just give you more options, allow you to sculpt a game plan and better like plan your sequencing, stuff like that. I also wasn't very happy with the 16 land. While I realized that the sample size of these four matches is not very large, let's just say that the games that I played have not convinced me that this alternative build of the deck is better than what I had been running previously. I mean, obviously I'm, well, kind of biased, and there are advantages and disadvantages to running like 16 or 17 land, or running like four copies of these blue cards. And now I'm only focusing on the downsides. But, well, as I said, I just haven't been convinced that the upsides are substantial enough by the games that I played. I haven't really had a chance to test out this plan against Jund or Blue-White-Red. I do believe that Edge Champion might have helped me in some of the matchups, maybe against like the Blue-Red Delver deck, for example. It might have helped stabilize the board a bit. So I guess there's still more testing to be done. One thing that I do know is that Ensoul Artifact plus Ornithopter is pretty sweet. Or same goes with Ensoul plus Vault Scourge. But we did see a huge 5/5 flyer, an Ornithopter getting in for a lot of damage with Ensoul Artifact in the games that I played. And that's definitely valuable. So I certainly see the role of Ensoul Artifact in this deck, and I will keep a couple in my deck going forward. But as I mentioned, drawing multiples can be kind of clunky. I also think that 8 colored cards with only in total 12 colored sources is not the best mix. So I still prefer my previous versions with 17 lands and fewer colored spells. Still, well, was interesting to see how this works, and I might play a bit more. Thank you all for watching, and see you soon.